Good afternoon, Mrs. Schmidt.
Good afternoon, Joe.
And how are you today?
Just fine, just fine. Good. And a beautiful day at White Lake.
It's incredible Michigan day.
Yeah.
Would you give your full name and, if you wish, your date of birth?
Certainly. Full name is Amy Jean Murdoch Schmidt.
Okay.
Murdoch is spelled with an H.
And you were born in?
1915. September 4th.
Okay, can you give us a background on how your family got to White Lake and when your first years were at Sylvan Beach?
Yes. My father at the time was in the coal business, and he had business in Muskegon, and he came up in those days. He just got on the train and he went to Muskegon. And so he came up here, and the man he was seeing knew that my father was a great fisherman and hunter and all this stuff, and he stayed at a afternoon or something. So he said, there's a nice little lake up north here, let's just go on up and fish. So they went up to Whitehall and rented a boat and went out and rowed, I guess, because I don't think there were any motors in those days. And first thing he did was catch a muskellunge. Well, I think it was the last muskellunge that was ever caught in White Lake anyway. And they caught a lot of fish, and it was wonderful. Then they took the ferry. There were two ferries that ran around the lake, the Three Sisters and the Edna May. And Chester Spickelmeyer drove one of them. He was very young at the time, about 18.
What year was this project?
That was 1920.
And
so they got off up here and looked around, and that cottage down there,
the Murdoch
cottage, well, it belonged to the Pattons from Grand Rapids. The Pattons and the Baines, Mrs. Patton and Mrs. Bain, were sisters. And they built it originally as a fishing camp. And they had a boathouse down on White Lake with a launch. And the cottage was, they for some reason wanted to sell it, and they sold the house. Or they were asking $2,000 for it. So my father bought it. Went home and told my mother, Carlisle, where is this place? It's the end of the world. But anyway, so then the next year, the first year we came up was 1921. And I was five, six maybe. And been here ever since.
What was your first memories of Sylvan Beach and White Lake? What would you say played a very big, prominent part in your mind?
I don't know. There were a lot of children. There were a lot of people my age, you know, little ones.
Mm-hmm.
And we all got to know each other. I mean, I've known all these people, and most of them are still around. Since I was 6 years old, and like Lucy Lee Jackman and Dot Brewer, and Lucy Lee isn't with us anymore, but Ed Middleton, you know, all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, we had a good time. We just sort of played. We were on the beach, and I mean, this is before we got into sailing or anything like that, when we were real little. And I was in the Jinx in 1922.
Do you remember what number you were in?
I can't remember what we did, but we were dressed in pajamas and had a pillow. And there were quite a few of us. And Andy Min Bigler was the adult in the act. And I really don't remember what the number was called, what we did. And
who did the Jinx that year?
Well, this was the Frank Adams years.
Oh, yes.
And these were really quite elegant performances, because they rented the costumes from Chicago. And then, I remember in later years, it's still in the 20s, but my grandmother, everybody's grandmother, would sit down and sew a lot of the costumes. And But those were really good, wonderful productions. And
What year do you remember Frank Adams not doing the Jinx? What was the first year that you can remember?
Well, it was, I think it was just before Lorna would know that. Okay. I know there were several years there when we didn't have one during the war, and then Barb Vandeventer, Barb and Judy and Nancy, she got this thing together. It was just a little short show, just sort of little skits.
Was that on somebody's porch?
No, it was at the Wob Club. And that was the first one after the Frank Adams years.
Do you remember approximately what year that was?
It was in the 40s, I think.
Okay, it was in the 40s.
I believe. Now, Barb would know.
Okay.
You better talk to her.
Yeah, I already have.
Have you talked to Bob Lanier?
No, I'm good.
Oh, you've got to talk to him. He really.
Sunday, and he said he had to check with his wife.
Yeah.
Yeah. How many members in your family when you first started to come up? You and...
Well, just my sister. We were the only children. And my mother and father, and then my grandmother and grandfather Lothman came up the next year, and they rented the Angelo's cottage now for a year or two, and then they bought the one down here, which was the Hooten cottage, and then they've been here many years too, and
can you tell us something about she certainly was a remarkable person that I remember from my childhood and when I was growing up.
Oh, sure. Oh, she was great. And she's very athletic and very popular. Mm-hmm. Oh, she was Miss Popularity Queen. And we hardly spoke a civil word until she was about 14. See, there was about almost 4 years difference between us. And
so the usual sibling type of rivalry.
Yeah, so, well, I don't know. She was always such a little pest, I kept thinking. But then all of a sudden things, once she got to a certain age, everything was fine. And
she was quite the sailor, right?
Oh, yes.
Well, both of you.
Yeah. We have some trophies to show for it. And we sailed all the time.
When you were growing up here, I suppose your younger years, it was just a real magic to the place. From just being
well, yes, and in the first place, there wasn't any place to go, and really and nothing to do, except I mean, you did it right here on the beach. But as we got older, you know, and got behind the wheel of cars, things changed a little bit.
Yeah, speaking of cars, I've heard a story several times that I believe you broke your back or your neck.
Well, it's crushed a vertebrae.
Crushed a vertebrae. Can you tell us how this happened?
Well, we were all going into Muskegon to go bowling. Don't ask why, but we were. And it was Ed Middleton, Bill Hartz was driving, and Fiffy, and Mac Butterfield.
What year was this?
Oh, 38, I think. 37 or 38. And we were going over the Giles Road, and it was raining a little bit. And I don't know how fast Bill was going, pretty fast. And all of a sudden, the car just sort of slid quietly sideways, and just slid down the middle of the road, and it hit the gravel and then turned over a couple of times and landed upright. And so I didn't want to grab onto Bill. I'm in the middle of the front seat. And so I grab onto Ed. Mac had the presence of mind to get Fiffy down on the floor in the back seat, because the back end of the car was kind of crushed down to the seat. And so we end up, and as we went over, Ed and I fell out the door onto the street, and he had a whole torn shoulder, and he had a bad shoulder, ligaments and everything. And I must have hit on my head or something, and I had a crushed vertebrae. Well, it didn't hurt at all at first, you know, but...
Were you knocked out, or...?
Just briefly, just for a minute. And but my ear was cut. This is, you know, the lobe.
Yeah, the lobe.
Well, I tell you, it was the worst bunch of blood you ever saw. And so, well, and somebody that we knew from the up here on the beach came by and piled us all in the car and took us to the hospital.
And which hospital?
Oh, Hackley.
Hackley. Okay.
I think it was the only one. No Mercy was there at the time. No, it was Hackley. I think we went to. And so then we all were released, and then the next day things, my back started to hurt, and so anyway, so I end up back in the hospital. That was, I did go to Mercy that time, in a cast from here to here. That's how they did it in those days, but I could walk in it. And
for how long did you wear this cast?
Oh God, it seemed forever. I don't know. It was two or three. Well, anyways, then when they finally got me home, I had to go on the train. But that was wonderful fun. I'm on a stretcher, and they had to put me through the train window to get me into the train.
How darn!
It was kind of fun, actually, and so anyway. But anyway, it all turned out just fine, and.
The police weren't there.
No.
Were you drinking at the time or anything?
No.
Just a good old fashioned.
Just accident. Yeah.
And accidents do happen.
So.
You mentioned Lucy Lee Jackman.
Oh yes,
Lucy Lee. Would you tell us about?
Oh yeah. Well, she was my dearest friend. She. I've known her, you know, since she was here. She was here before I was. She came as a little baby, and. She was, her maiden name was McDonald. She was Lucy Lee McDonald. And her grandfather was Mr. James Middleton. And so she's a cousin. She and Dot and Ed and Midge Forrester were cousins. And what was it? There were a bunch of them, too. The Works. You remember the Works?
Yeah, the
Works. Dr. Work and because they had the old Middleton cottage then for a while.
Okay. Isn't Mrs. Summer a Work?
No, she's not related. She was a little.
A little, okay.
Little. And but they've been coming up for a long, long time, too. As long as I have. And
at the time that you were growing up here, do you remember the Sylvan Beach Hotel?
Oh, of course.
Would you want to tell us about it? Any special memories or things that you remember?
No. Well, I don't know. I never stayed there, but we did occasionally have Sunday dinner there.
So they had a dining room there.
Oh, yes, they had a dining room. But where we mostly had dinner was down at Murray's Inn. They had a wonderful dining room, and they had chicken and dumplings every Sunday.
And that's in that old main building?
Yeah.
The big main building.
The big main building. And, but I knew people, you know, who had stayed there. As a matter of fact, when they tore it down, I have a dresser upstairs that came out of the Sylvan Beach Hotel.
When did they tear that down?
Oh. I don't know. It was in the late 40s, I guess. I don't really remember. It would, because.
Post Second World War, though, probably.
I think so, because that's, you see, when the Downings, Lucy Lee's mother, Vera, who married Blatchford Downing, well, they built that cottage there, and that's approximately where the. Sylvan Beach Hotel was.
And then
where the stones are, that was the other cottage that was built on that property.
So the Sylvan Beach Hotel was not, you're not talking about where the Jackman Cottage is now.
Yeah,
and the Holloway Cottage.
No, that's the annex. That was the old Sylvan Beach Hotel annex.
So right where Jackman's
and the stones are is where it was.
Stones.
Yeah, because Annie and Ben Field built that one. And then sold it, and Skipper Lothman had it for a while too. He was in there.
How many people stayed in the hotel? I mean, was it a big hotel? Was it?
I don't know. It was a pretty good size hotel. Maybe there were 80 rooms or round in there, okay. 60, 80. And one bathroom down at the end of the hall, you know.
Did the rooms have sinks or anything like that?
Yes, I think they all did. Had a sink in them, and most of these cottages did too, because there was usually just one bathroom, and it was always off the kitchen, for some reason or other. Water didn't run upstairs very well in those days, I guess.
Gravity.
Yeah.
So a little harder.
Yeah.
Approximately what year was that hotel built?
Well, it was here before we came. I don't know. You could probably find out in Dave Forbes's book, might have it in.
Right, I think it does.
I don't remember that, but it was.
But it was after 1920, basically.
Oh no, it was built before that. Oh yes.
Okay.
And it was built maybe 1914, 15, I don't really know.
Who ran it? Do you have any?
Well, Mr. Duttenhofer ran it for a long time. And he owned it, I guess. And he lived, I think, we lived over on South Shore Drive. I think it was where the Kleinfelters are now. And I think he originally built that house and then sold it to the Hanchets, who was Joe Hartman's family.
She's Joe, okay, that's
right. And because they lived there for a long time in the 20s, 30s.
What are, you know, this place has had a lot of people come and go, and there are characters, for instance, like your son, Doug Schmidt, is very famous.
Yeah.
Do you remember, they don't have to be famous, but the notable characters that were here that you knew, the people that were just characters.
Oh, I'll tell you.
Famous or not famous or whatever.
They were all famous around here.
For what we won't say.
Yeah, I tell you, I don't know. Of course, there's Jane Pelton. But Jane Pelton's mother was one of a kind, I'll tell you.
What did she do?
She was just a funny, quite a domineering lady. But she couldn't hold a candle to Mrs. Chittenden, Harriet's mother.
Oh, okay.
And she was another character.
Were there sparks there?
No. I think they all got along pretty well, but they all were, maybe they weren't even very friendly. I don't even know. Then there was old Mr. Flitcraft, who every 4th of July, he lived in the house, the Stormy Webbers, the Josephs and that one.
Weber, right.
Yeah, and every 4th of July he would have a watermelon party in the front yard and invite every kid on the beach. And we would get all dressed up in our best dresses, you know, and the boys had on white suits and things like that, and we weren't very big. And we'd all sit there and get watermelon all down our lovely dresses and spit the seeds over the bank. And that went on for quite a number of years.
About approximately what years were those?
Those were in the 20s.
20s, that he would do.
Yeah, because I was not very old.
Was Mr. In the Forbes book, we have a view of Mr. Flitcraft being somewhat at war with Sylvan Beach over the sewers and the pipes and that, but people I've talked to give me a different impression about it.
Well, I don't, as I say firsthand, I don't know anything much about it, but that sidewalk that used to go down there, it's in between the Petersons and Joe's houses over there, was called Division Walk. And that, see, Mr. Flitcraft owned all that property. And on that's on the other side of the walk. And he had his own, and there were, oh, several cottages there. Big cement, stucco gray things. And one of them was named Quitchawurry. All the cottages had names in those days. And, but.
What was the name of your cottage?
Lady Bank. That one down there. This one, as far as I know, didn't ever have a name, but probably did. But Bob Lanier still has the original sign for his cottage. He's got it up. And the one that Midge Forrester was in, that was Pine Lodge. I remember that one. And the little cottage. Can't remember.
Flickers, you were getting into the subdivision or the division there.
Yeah, well, that was Division Walk, and then the Murrays. I don't know whether they bought the property from Mr. Flitcraft or already owned it, but they owned that. They always owned the hotel part down there, and part of that up to the lighthouse. Then, of course, the lighthouse was. Government property, and but I can remember Mr. Bush was the lighthouse keeper, and he when the pier had the top deck, and he would go out there every night and light all the lights, and then get up in the tower when there was a fog or something and grind out the fog horn.
Was it a siren or a?
Yeah, well, it was a foghorn. But it was, I don't think it was, well, it must have been electrically operated. And, but I know the lights had to be
manually
turned on someplace. And,
so then Murray's owned that down there, and then. The division with Mr. Flitcraft,
yeah,
across the lawn to the Peterson.
Yeah.
And is that the reason I'm asking this was in the Forbes book, it's kind of a big thing when the Flitcrafts were trying to install the sewer, but also an impression I'm receiving of Mr. Flitcraft is that he was also a very kind and generous man.
Oh, well, yes. Well, of course, I was so little, and then he died, I don't know when, but I wasn't very old. Maybe 10, 12 or something. But he said something that reminded me of something.
Sure. And now
it's it's called short-term memory loss. Yeah. he was a character. Oh, another character, of course, Mr. Sidoni.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Mr. Sidoni.
Do you want to talk about Mr. Sidoni?
Well, I
have memories of Mr. Sidoni.
Oh, yes. Way back, I don't know, it was Lucy Lee and I, we were about 19 or so, 18 or 19, and we came up here for two or three summers around Memorial Day and were allowed to stay in the Middleton cottage. By ourselves, and the Sidoni boys would come over all the time, and we'd have a grand time with them. And and one weekend during one of the years we were up here, we were invited over to spend the weekend with the Sidonis. That was an experience. And Mr. Sidoni would start sort of go into a trance every once in a while, and
oh, really?
Just yeah, he'd be off somewhere else. Some terrible catastrophe was happening somewhere, and But I think he was very good.
Do you believe him to be sincerely a very a gifted psychic?
Oh, yes. I think he was. Oh, yes. I don't think there's any doubt about that. He wasn't always right, of course. But no, he had lots of. See, they lived in Hollywood for some years in the very early, I guess it was even in the very, 1915 to maybe 19, anyway. And he was advising the stars and of the time. And then I don't know how, somehow they got up here. You'll have to ask Arthur about that.
Okay. And, something yeah. told me he wasn't doing very well.
Well, he looks all right. He's working over at the golf club
okay.
now
so
again.
Like
yeah, I think he had something. And Joe died, you know. And
yeah.
In,
yeah, I miss Joe.
Yeah, I do too. Joe was great.
Oh, he's always so
good. I'd always count on Joe to take you to the yacht club dance if you didn't have a date.
Well, even Peg Dilley told a story where Mr. Sidoni came and picked her up one night and took them to the yacht club. Mr. Sidoni had quite a few notable persons come and visit.
Oh, him. Yeah.
Do you remember any
sure.
of
them? Sure. Well, I can remember. The first ones I remember were Joan Crawford and Douglas Fairbanks Jr., and they'd just been married. They were very young. And but they were rising stars.
About what year was it?
24 or 25, something like that.
Where did you see them first?
Well, actually, we all knew they were here, but they would stay up there, you know, at the Valley of the Pines. And every once in a while, they would get out in a speedboat or something and speed around the lake. And so, of course, the minute they appeared, we knew who they were because Joe or Art was always with them. So we'd all rush out in our boats. Well, nobody had anything that went very fast besides a sailboat or something. But anyway, so we did, actually, we just sort of saw them in passing. But I did go on a double date with Sophie Tucker.
Can you tell us about that?
Well, it was wonderful. She was visiting up there. And I tell you, she was a great gal. They had a yacht club dance, you know, big. The yacht club dances were pretty big stuff in those days. And I think it was some special occasion. I don't remember exactly what it was, but she happened to be here. And she came, and Mr. and Mrs. Sidoni, Mr. Sidoni and Sophie were in the front seat. And Mrs. Sidoni and Joe and Arthur and I are in the back seat. They had a great big car, you know, with the jump seats and everything. And I think Sophie was supposed to be Art's date, and I was supposed to be Joe's date. Anyway, so we get to the yacht club, and she was wonderful. They asked her, somebody came up and asked her if she would sing for us. And she entertained for about a half an hour, just singing and just being great. And
so found her to be very down to earth and very.
Oh yeah, she was very very nice, very nice, and
that's great. Who else can you remember that went to see Mr. Sidoni?
Oh, I think a lot of people did. Commander McDonald, you know, Zenith Corporation. He used to come over a lot, and he had a great big yacht that was wonderful. A lot of big yachts used to come in then.
Do you remember the Joseph 30s. Schlitz yacht? The Hugh Line, I guess?
The E-Lines. The Atlantic. You mean that three-masted schooner? Oh, that was a beautiful boat, and he was awful nice, too. He'd take us all out on a little trip and...
Just a side question here, Anna. It's just a social type. Do you find that people today are more snobby that have that are famous or power or things like that than they were then? Or do you see any?
Well, I don't really know. I don't know that many of them.
I don't know. Yeah. It seems like people were very down to earth. I mean,
yeah.
It was more of a
Well, of course, the movies were still pretty new in those days, in the 20s, and there wasn't the publicity or the media, television, any of that stuff. You got all your information from movie magazines. And according to the movie magazines, everybody was simply wonderful.
Impeccable.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember any other people that were around that were notable?
Well,
characters?
Well, let's see. Can't think of any just offhand.
Okay. Well, there is somebody very famous that I know that you do know, and that's your son, Doug.
Oh, Douglas.
Doug was a Sylvan Beecher, still is.
Yes, and he got his start in the Jinx.
And I remember his Jinxes very well.
Yes, I do too, because he always spent a lot more money than he was supposed to. I think he still does, but anyway. But I know he did have one wonderful, I thought it was very innovative, a number. It was the kick line. And it was a number called Steam Heat. This was the old stage, and there were an awful lot of knot holes in the stage.
I remember getting my toes a little very cold.
So you had all the little boys on the beach underneath with these CO2 cans squirting them up through these knot holes. It looked like steam was coming up all over the stage.
I remember that.
Yeah.
I think every fire extinguisher on Sylvan Beach was empty by Saturday night.
Oh, yeah. And
that was an incredible number.
Well, that was pretty good. And that was the, and I won't mention the, no, I better not say anything about the chorus line. At that time, they had three of the most inept dancers I think we've ever had.
I believe, yes.
Yes.
When did, now Doug, and I remember that I still have a record that your son put out.
Oh, yes, the George Washington Bridge Company or something like that.
The song that I remember was the Ohio River Monster. Got a monster?
Yeah, I don't know that. Anyway.
How did he did the Jinxes, and then how did he get into show business?
Well, I don't know. He was kind of born for the theater, and if you can't fight him, join him. So when it was time to go to college, he went to BU. Well, I didn't know what BU was, so it's Boston University is what it is. And he picked that out himself, and he got himself there. And they don't even have a campus. It's just
downtown.
Well, it's kind of it's right across the river from Cambridge and Harvard, but it's just a bunch of sort of buildings. And the dormitory was an old hotel that was there. And but anyway, he got into the fine arts part. And one of his teachers was a man named Raymond Sovey, who was a very famous designer in the early 30s. And so he was there for about 3 years and doing very well. And Mr. Sovey called him in one day and he said, Douglas, Ming Cho Lee he was the big designer in the early 60s. And he said, Ming Cho Lee is looking for an apprentice. Why don't you go down and try out for it? So he gets himself down to New York, and there are five or six people trying out, and all from the Harvard and the Yale drama school and everything else. And so lo and behold, Douglas got the job. And he never went back to BU. Take it when you can get it.
He got his degree there and went on to be...
He did. Is somebody out there?
No, I'm just checking my equipment.
Oh.
Sorry, I should have wanted to make sure.
No, but he... he's done very, very well.
Yeah, can you tell us some of the plays he's done?
He's done so many. It's just...
And who he worked for, the Met, and...
Well, he did quite a lot of work for the San Francisco Opera. And he hadn't worked, didn't work for the Met, but San Francisco Opera and the Chicago Lyric, and Seattle too. Seattle has a big opera company.
Well, I can remember him reading a review in Newsweek where Doug Schmidt was mentioned, and the quote was, and as usual, the Doug Schmidt sets are...
Oh, yeah. He always got wonderful reviews, even if the show didn't go.
He
actually got his start, I guess he was 17, and he was in a summer theater up in Camden, Maine. And of course, he didn't get paid or anything like that. And he was fourth assistant carpenter. And so he got room and board. And he worked in a lot of summer theaters. And, you know, in the summer. Well, anyway, so when he finally got to New York, and he did a lot of, he was Ming's assistant for, maybe 4 or 5 years. And then branched out on his own. His first real big, really, really big hit was Grease. And that ran for 7 years. He hasn't been so lucky with some of the other ones
that
he's
done.
I
didn't know that. Grease was fantastic. I'll be damned. And he just this year is doing something, wasn't he? This
it's a big, it's a spectacular. It was put on by, it's called George Lucas Live Adventure. And it was put on by Kenneth Feld was the producer, and he is Mr. Barnum and Bailey Circus and the Ice Follies and that kind of stuff. And this is a spectacular. It's not when you move from place to place. The sets are 50 feet high. It's unreal. And so that has since opened. Oh, they rehearsed in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Which is where your niece is.
Yeah, so I stayed with Amy for a couple of days.
Daughter.
Yeah, and so I stayed with her and saw the dress rehearsal, and that was cheaper than going to Yokohama. I'll tell you. I thought it was just, of course they'd stop it every 15 minutes because there'd be some glitch somewhere. And but you get the general idea. I thought it was very good. We didn't get all the explosions that night because the explosion man was sick in bed with the flu, so we couldn't do those. It was good, and it's doing fine in Japan. Oh, it was all Japanese money. They paid for the whole thing, and the Japanese pay very well. So
at least he's being paid now.
Oh yeah, because he had that. His last flop was Nick and Nora, which ran for 9 days, and
question. Your dog is very famous. You also have a son, Jim, who's been the president of the golf club.
Can you
tell us something about Jim?
Well, Jim is a very fine golfer. He went in the family business. Well, he went into the family business. He sort of had to. And after Robert died. And he did well in that. And he finally, about 2 years ago, he sold the business because it got to the point where you can't compete. These small surgical houses can't compete with Johnson & Johnson and American Hospital Supply, and it's all throwaway stuff now. And so he sold it. And then he decided he wanted to be a teacher. So he's been going to school full time for 2 years. And next week he gets his degree or whatever he gets, or whatever certification, so he can teach. And he's already been assigned to school. And I thought he'd be assigned to one of the basin schools or something, because don't they usually assign the new teachers?
Well, yeah.
To some of the worst ones? Well, this
I was assigned to a tough one.
So this is really quite a nice school.
Great.
It's out in the suburbs. And
he was president of the golf club for what?
Oh, yes, 9 years.
Nine years.
And then he decided that 9 years was enough. And
Jim has always been one of the more kind, gracious people that we have here.
Yes.
We mentioned, you just hit upon it, but I understand your husband. I don't remember him that well.
Yeah.
He was a real character.
He was indeed. Yes.
Can you tell us some things about him and these stories you have?
I don't know.
Marty, I've heard a few.
Everybody has, I'm sure. I can't think of anything specific right now.
Well, Betsy Ross was telling me about the time, or Betsy Davis was telling me about the time that she appeared in a Broadway play, Oklahoma, and they went to Cincinnati and then went to...
Oh, yeah, that's right. The whole cast.
Yeah. Can you tell us about that? I heard that
I don't know.
Singing when they entered.
Oh, yeah. So they. Oh, yeah, he was singing. We had just bought the record, of Oklahoma. And, it was... Oh, Joel Gray was in it, in that company. And they were leaping all over from one end of the living room to the other, and they were doing the whole show all over again, practically, having a wonderful time. And
I heard it went all night.
It did. It went for a long time. We had food and drink, and I don't know when they finally left. I don't remember.
What did you think of Joel Gray?
He was little. He was little. No, they were all fun.
They were all nice.
They were all nice. They were all fun. And very entertaining. And they were all young, too.
Mm-hmm.
And
now, back to your husband. He founded this business, this hospital supply business?
No. His grandfather had. See, Jimmy was the fifth generation in the business. And so when Robert's father died, Robert was suddenly it, and he was only 26.
Did he attend college?
Oh, yes, he went to Cornell. And
what did he get his degree in?
Well, he didn't actually. I don't think he never actually graduated. I think after he had the piano hauled up to the top floor at Bolt Hall in Cornell and sent his father the bill for $25. His father said, "All right, Robert, that's it. Come home and go to work." And
I'm so, not paying for any pianos to be home.
Right. Anyway, those were the Depression days too,
Can you tell us something about the Depression years up here, or the Depression, your memories of the Depression year?
Well, I don't know. I just don't. Everybody was in the same boat. Nobody had any money, and I was going to the university at home, Cincinnati, and I had a wonderful time, and I had an allowance of $5 a week, and that I had a car. And so I would pick up people and take them to school, and back, and I would get paid 50 cents or something for that. And nobody had any money. And
just times were bad.
Times were bad. And everybody was in the same boat, and we had a good time, a fine time. We didn't. And everything was very inexpensive also. We used to splurge, and we'd go downtown for lunch on Saturdays, and I think the whole lunch cost about $1.50. And
do you have any memories of the Depression at Sylvan Beach? Also, was there?
No, not really. Everybody managed to come up here. I think there were a couple of people who were really hurt badly by it, and one was the Seckles. You don't remember them.
No.
Just
generally tightened the belt.
Well, Mr. Seckle was He won the Western Open golf. He was an amateur. And he won it 1 year. And so he designed the seventh hole over at White Lake Golf Club. And the original design was, it was very similar to what it is now, except it had sand traps all the way around it in the back. And they were deep. And they were awful. That was a tough hole.
Now that's still there.
Yeah, well, the sand traps in the back are gone, but there's still some in the front. But it's still basically the same design.
What age did you start playing golf?
Oh, I don't know. I was about 13 or 14, I guess.
Because you're known as quite the good golfer.
Yeah, well, I used to be pretty good, but not anymore. Well, I still hit the ball once in a while, but I can't hit it far, and I bloop down the middle, and I enjoy it. I'm glad to be out there doing it.
Any notable characters from the golf club you remember, or who was president then, or people that were the main driving force in the golf club?
Well, I don't know. Of course, there was George Hartman, mm-hmm. who was, when George, well, there was a tree on the number 16. No, wait a minute. Where is that tree? Number nine. Going up. It was a great big some kind of tree. And it was struck by lightning and gone. So George, and this must have been 35 or 40 years ago, he had another tree, and he had this tearful ceremony, goodbye old friend, and here is new friend, a new friend. It was a pretty sizable tree, you know, something about this big around when it was put in. Well, it's this big around now, so it's been a long time ago. New friend is causing just as much trouble as old friend did. And
getting in the way.
Yeah,
certainly George Hartman was a prime.
Oh, yes. He was very influential over there. And he also was pretty active in the yacht club, too.
Yeah, what are your memories of the yacht club?
Oh, well, we spent all summer over at the yacht club, for heaven's sakes.
Who were your, did you have a junior yacht club?
Oh, yes, yes, indeed.
Who were your Commodores, or people that were involved pretty heavily in it?
Oh, I don't know, Bill Getz, Freddie French. Well, you wouldn't, nobody'd remember Freddie, except me.
Tell me something about Freddie. Who was Freddie French?
Freddie French, well, he had an A-boat, and those were the days when they still were 5 or 6 A's around. But you had to have a crew of 5 with those, and it caused a bit of problem. The Sedonis had one, and Jack Garin had one, and I've forgotten who the other ones were, but Freddie French had one. And every once in a while, on a beautiful night, when the wind was out of the east, we'd all go out sailing with Freddie. And of course, there were no running lights on anything, on sailboats or anything. So one of us would wear a red sweater, and the other would wear a green sweater, and we'd stand up with a flashlight underneath these sweaters going in and out of the channel. But there wasn't much traffic in the channel then anyway in those days, very little. Because we would swim across the channel and go up to Pigeon Hill, run up to the top of Pigeon Hill 3 or 4 times. Well, I don't know how we did it.
And the run down was always fun.
Yeah.
The run up was always...
And then we'd swim back. And there was never no boats or anything there.
Can you tell us... you mentioned we talked before the tape went on. I just asked about the ferry that went across the channel.
Yeah.
That only operated for a short time?
Just not very long, 2 or 3, couple of years, I think.
About 1930s?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
I don't think it, I know it wasn't more than 4 or 5 years. It may have been less.
And, okay. Oh, and while we're on that's not that subject, but your family, your niece Amy yesterday,
yeah,
also has her own TV show. You want
oh
to
yes, indeed
that?
She does.
Just the,
well, it's a it's an aerobic thing. She does aerobics, and she has a very good show called Home Stretch, and she's on public PBS on most of their stations, and but she's on at a different time on every one. You know, it's all taped and everything. And I happened to catch her this morning at 6:30, and I was so exhausted by the time she'd finished this program, I could hardly get up.
Is she a lot just? Is she a lot like her mother?
Yes, very much, very much. And she looks like her and acts like her. And
Fifi, I gather, was always the peacemaker from what I've heard, that always kept things on an even balance.
Well, yeah, she was always, she...
Somewhat like Amy, I think.
Yeah.
A very special person.
And, but they're doing fine in Charlotte.
Do you have any memories or just share any experiences at all about Prohibition up here? Any memories of it? Any?
Well, sort of. I never went to. I did go to a speakeasy at home once or twice.
Would you have to knock on the door to get in there?
Oh, yeah, it was good. Well, God, I was only 16 years old or something like that, you know. And I don't know why they let us in anyway. The boys weren't much older. But up here, there was always some place that was, Bud Runyon knew them all. He used to go, but he used to tell us about them.
This will be a double question, really. Do you find that there's a greater amount of cocktail parties and parties now?
Oh yes.
Than there was.
Oh yes. Yeah.
Do you think that's good or indifferent? Do you think the social aspect is?
Well, I tell you, I don't think it's. I think it's more, you know, my age group that are having all these cocktail parties. And well, there weren't any when we were young. I mean, we never had any.
With Prohibition, I'm sure. Do you remember your parents drinking during Prohibition?
Oh, yes. Everybody could always get something somewhere, you know. But they didn't ever drink much.
Do you know where they got it when they were up here?
No. I have a feeling that it all got brought in from places like Chicago and Cincinnati.
Did your kids get a hold of any ever to beach parties when you were young?
No, but I remember Lucy Lee and Fifi and I took the kids down to the beach one nice day. We were here, all the husbands were working somewhere, we took him down to the beach, and I think Jimmy was about 4. Jimmy and FG were about 4. And we had hot dogs, and we were drinking, I think it was grapefruit juice and rum, or some awful concoction like that. We had a little jug of it and in a paper cup. And so I'm all busy cooking the hot dogs for these kids, and I turn around and here is Jimmy draining this grapefruit juice and rum. Why, the kid was absolutely drunk. I mean, he's laughing and falling down in the sand. Well, we all thought it was pretty funny, but I didn't realize till a lot later that it could have been very dangerous. And I had to carry him up all these steps.
5 years old.
Yes, 4. Oh, the lump.
Well, that must have been the talk of the beach for a while.
Yeah, well,
that's true. Ginny's getting her children
drunk on the beach. Oh, dear.
So, yeah, they're really, during your Prohibition years up here, you don't have any.
No, no, no.
Were there drugs back then? Of course, there were drugs back then.
Well, there were, but I remember somebody once said they smoked grass once. Well, I guess that's marijuana. So we didn't even know what grass was. Now, we were all pretty naive.
Yeah. And, nothing wrong with that. Do you remember during the Second World War? Do you have any memories of the Second World War here? Rationing?
Yeah, oh, you bet.
Problems?
Yes. Well, there wasn't any problems, but, we caught fish. We caught a lot of fish that summer. And,
Did you have any problems getting gasoline to come up here from Cincinnati?
Well, yeah, not really, because, Robert had a B card, which was pretty, I just had an A card. And I don't know, we just sort of saved him up. We didn't go anyplace. Had enough to get up here and back.
How long of a drive was it back then?
Oh, God, forever.
Forever, a couple day trip.
Well, when we were when I was little, it took 2 days to get up here. But it was about a 9 hour drive. 9, sometimes 10, back in the 40s.
Two-lane days.
And
when did you usually get up here when you were growing up? Would it be like today?
I think like the 4th of July. We'd always come, I guess, around the 1st of July.
And would you stay the whole summer then?
Oh, yes, you came. Oh, yes, and he would go back on the train, you see. And the train just ran right out of Muskegon, right to Cincinnati, and wonderful. And it went to Grand Rapids and then went to Cincinnati, but you didn't have to get off the train.
Yeah.
And but then the trunks would be sent up and delivered by Brightwell, the back door. And when you're there, I mean, once you were here for the summer. And
During the Second World War, I believe, wasn't there a loss of Fifi's husband? Wasn't he killed?
Yes, he was killed in the war.
Could you tell us something about him and what happened?
Well, he was a pilot, and he was based in someplace in Italy. I don't remember the name of the base. And when FG was born, he got the telegram, you know, and he thought, well, he hitched a ride. He wasn't flying that day, but he hitched a ride. They were taking some of the pilots who were on their way back home, back to the States. So he hitched a ride with them, and it crashed into a mountain. And he wasn't even in combat. You know, it was just one of those things. And
that's terrible.
So,
yeah, and that was F.G. Baldwin.
Right.
Baldwin was the son. How soon after that did Fifi marry?
I don't know about. F.G. was just a baby, and he was about four years. And
do you have any other memories of the Second World War here? Any other casualties or people that were killed, or any experiences that you can remember?
Joe Runyon was killed.
Joe Runyon. Did you know what branch he was in?
He was a flyer too, flyer. Pilot. Yeah.
Was he killed in the Pacific or?
No, he was killed in. It was one of those accidents.
Yeah,
one of those dumb things. He was in a bomber. And I don't know, somehow he was down in the doing something and the bomb bay doors opened and he went down in the ocean. And
a lot of people would see when everybody gathers together in large amounts.
Yeah.
A lot of accidents happen. Any other memories of the war? Anything in the war, Second World War period? Do you remember hard time getting tires, or do you remember any like the victory in the Italian campaign, let's say, Kasserine Pass.
Yeah.
Did you get the news fairly quick?
Oh, sure, yeah.
Did you listen to the radio?
Oh, yeah, we listened to the radio a lot. Because we could always get good Chicago, you see.
Did you have a... What type of... Did you all gather around at night and listen to it? Did you have certain shows?
Oh, yeah, there were a lot of shows.
Can you tell some of the shows?
Oh, so those shows were wonderful. There were a lot of variety shows. What are the names of them now? Used to know them all.
I listened to Jack Benny's
show. Oh, yes, the Jack Benny show, and there was the Lux Radio Theater and the Something Else Theater, and there were a lot of them. And
during the war years, did you your family fairly attentive here during the summer, even though it was the summer, to what was going on? Did you keep track of events?
Well, yeah.
But being young,
more or less.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. You know, it was all my friends who were over there fighting.
Yeah.
And so we were pretty aware. And but I don't think there was anything special. No dreadful hardships.
Do you remember the... Can you tell us about the arcade? Do you remember the arcade?
Oh, yes, I remember the arcade well.
Were you one of the crowd that used to go down there and wait for telegrams? And
no, no. I tell you who that was. That was Liz Ehlers, who used to run up the hill and deliver the telegrams. And... yeah, I think she was about 10 or 8 or something, and she made a lot of dimes that year. And, no, but when the Carolina came in, and everybody would be down there, of course, to meet it.
What time would it come in?
Oh, about 5 o'clock. You could see it coming across the lake, way down there, and then by the time it got in and got to the dock, it was maybe 5:30, and then everybody'd get off, and then it went on down the lake and spent the night down. And
so it would get at 5:30 in the morning.
No, in the afternoon.
Saturday.
Friday evening, and then it would leave Sunday evening. And but we all went down, and I guess it was Sunday evening when we would all go down to watch him leave. And it was a lot of fun because the Naveen's boathouse was the first, well, it's not there anymore, but it was the first boathouse there. And it had a slip going out because there were several launches on the lake, and you just drive the boat right into the boathouse. It was wonderful. Our boathouse was like that, too, with the Bessie B. Just drive the Bessie B right into the boathouse, and there you were.
Was the lake higher then?
That boathouse had been moved back. Quite a ways.
Yeah.
Over the years. But in those days, I guess, you know, it was right out there where the water was.
Yeah.
And then the water rose, and then we moved the boathouse back, and...
Can you tell us during your lifetime, the lake, have you ever seen it as low or as high? Or do you think this is part of what's going on?
Oh, this is that seasonal, cyclical, I guess you call it, thing. I have some pictures on the beach of in the late 40s that there just wasn't any beach, you know, it was just... And,
so it was as high as it is now?
Okay. And then in the 30s, and it was very low. I know that lasted for several, and my father was always blaming the Chicago Drainage Canal. They were letting the water run out of Lake Michigan. So
things haven't changed much.
Yeah,
I don't think people are still blaming everything they can think of.
And...
Do you remember any? It's been an important part of our history. We never seem to talk about are the maids.
They had a wonderful time. Everybody had one.
Everybody had one.
Everybody had a black maid, colored maid. And of course, Nancy, Mrs. Chittenden's Nancy, was the social arbiter of the beach. And they always did. She had, of course, that little house out there over the garage, or that apartment over the garage behind the house. And everybody, they'd all gather there in the evening. And they had picnics, and they'd go to, they always, of course, went into Muskegon on Thursdays and Sundays. Sometimes Sundays they'd have beach parties.
On Sylvan Beach?
Well, there was some talk about that at one point, and so several of them got up and said, why can't they have a beach party down there? They don't do anything. They weren't drinking or yelling or anything. And so they did.
Well, that's good. And of course, that's easy in hindsight to say that's good. I'm sure the racial problem back then, it's easy when you see the wrong of things.
Yeah.
To say, but when you're raised with things. So Nancy was
she was the queen bee. And then after she died.
Well, you had Anna.
Anna. Yeah. Anna was the, took over. Years went by, and they were fewer and fewer, and now there's nobody except
the Bitters. Leona.
Leona. And Leona's got to be in her 80s.
So you don't have any other memory of the maids in particular? Did the maids tattle on you if you came in, if they caught you doing things coming in late?
Well, I don't know whether they did or not. Yeah. Well, of course, at that house down there, nobody had to tattle on anybody. You could hear everybody coming in and out.
Yeah. And, you know, I do remember Anna. She was so kind.
Oh, she was so nice.
I'd run up to see her. And she remember everybody and was just a very gracious.
Yeah,
lady.
Though she was, and she was the best cook. Oh my!
Do you remember? Were there any white maids?
None that I can remember.
Do you remember an incident at the woodwork cottage where a maid's hair caught fire?
No.
She died. Okay.
No, I don't recall that.
Mid-20s. Is Mrs. Nadine here now? Are there any Nadines here?
Yeah, Anne's here. Anne Reynolds.
Okay, now how is she?
Anne is the Mrs. John and Grace Devine's daughter.
Okay.
And Grace is still living, and she's down in Florida. And she's 87, I think Anne said.
And Anne will be here for a while?
Yeah.
Okay, well, if you see her, would you tell her I want to tape her too? I don't know.
Yeah. Oh, she'd love that. She's good, yeah.
She'll be here for probably a few weeks.
Yes. Okay. Well, you better get her. I don't know how long she's going to be here, but she's going to be here.
So back to the arcade. Well,
did you talk to Tim when he was here?
I saw him on the 4th of July. Yeah. I talked to him, but I didn't get him on tape. Everybody was busy doing, you know,
yeah,
certain things. Do you know if Tim's coming back?
I doubt it.
Dang.
Well, he promised me. Well, I'm very mad at him anyway, because many years ago, he was going to write a history of the Wabanango Jinx. And when we bought this cottage, in the desk drawer, I found two wonderful programs of Jinx programs, 1922 and 1921 or something in there. And so he said, could he borrow them? Well, I never saw them again. And he disappeared off the face of the earth, and he didn't come back for years. So I told him about that, and he said, oh yes, he said, I remember that. I think I can put my hands on him. So he said if he found him, he'd send him back to me. So I don't know if I'll ever get him or not. But
Yeah, it's.
I think Lorna or probably Peg have some old programs. And.
To the arcade again. Was that a, when you were younger, was that a center of your.
Oh, yes.
All meet down.
Oh, of course. Because that was the tennis courts were right there.
Now, I understand that right down there, too, there was a crossing guard or policeman?
Yes, we had a crossing guard. Well, he was sort of a policeman, and he'd stand there and stop everybody running, going through.
Approximately what years were those?
Oh, 30s, I guess.
Was there much traffic?
No, oh, not like today, but it seemed like a lot.
Yeah, sure.
But see, Murray's was going full steam then, and so was the Sylvan Beach Hotel. And so there was, you know, a fair amount of traffic.
And so you would just wait down there across the street, you'd probably just tell them, of course.
Yeah, well, but we, no, and then see, on the one side was the, well, the post office was in there, in that little
building.
And then on the one side was the soda fountain, and they had a little screened-in porch off the back by the on the dock, and on the other side was the grocery store, and that was run by young Edna and Leonard Bloomdahl, whose mother and father, the Kearns, ran the grocery store up in Whitehall. It was the only grocery store, I think.
Now, the fountain, was that run by Pitkins,
or was that soda? No, Mrs. Kern was always presiding over the soda fountain.
The fountain on the one side, and then you'd have Kerns on the other side also. Or were they both on the same?
It was the same. Well, they ran both sides.
Both sides, okay.
Both sides. The drugstore, it was a sort of a drugstore. Mostly a soda fountain. And
what
and they had a slot machine. And banana splits. Gosh, I don't know. I think a banana split was about 15 cents. Biggest things you ever saw. They were wonderful. And
do you remember who had the first phones around here? And were they a curse, a blessing?
Well, I think we put one in. I guess it was around in the 40s sometime. And we were it's a four-party line. And sometimes it was rather difficult. There was somebody on here who did nothing but talked all the time on it. I will not mention the name.
That's fine.
And
were they all, the four parties were Sylvan Beach parties?
Yeah, it was usually in a line, you know, right down the line. Except that there was me, and Dave and Verna and Polly and the other house were on the same party line. And it was very difficult to call the other house because you had to do something different than dial a number. You had to dial something, and then, I don't know, but it was, and then you hang up, then you'd have to hang up, and then it would ring in both places, and then when it stopped ringing, you'd pick it up when somebody maybe was at the other end of the line. But,
In the arcade, what year did that stop doing business, approximately?
Well, when the Carolina stopped coming in, which was, I guess, 40s, late 40s. I'm not very sure on that one. And then the dock, it was used for, we all fished off the dock. A lot of people did. And swim off the dock, and it was fine. And then it sort of rotted away, and nobody, I mean, this was a big dock.
Yeah. Well, it must have been.
And so it just kind of, then they just, it fell apart. They just took it down, yeah.
I guess at that time there was no effort in thought to save it.
Well, it was too expensive
to do
it. and needed all new pilings and all new everything. So, and
by the way, the Googans owned, you know, the Edson Cottage, which is now Minister's Cottage.
Yeah.
What cottage? Somebody was telling me that they weren't there always, that they were in another cottage.
No, they were. They first came up, they first stayed at the Sylvan Beach Hotel when they first came up. And then they were in, I think they rented that, where the Edsons. That belonged to old Mr. Naveen, real old Mr. Naveen.
And he was the prime
grandpa
back of the church.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Well, he and John. John was, too, the Ann's father. And
do you remember, somebody told me the other day that Eleanor Roosevelt came up when Ruth was married to Elliot. Do you remember
Yeah, I remember that. Because we were up here, it was in October, and they spent their honeymoon up here. And they were in Joe Hartman's cottage. Well, you couldn't go out the back door. The woods were crawling with Secret Service men all over the place.
Where did they stay?
What?
Where did the Secret Service men stay?
I have no idea. I don't know.
But they did?
They were around. They were around. And because we went, the Sidonis had a big A-boat, and they took... they took them and they invited us and I think somebody else out for a moonlight sail one night. And he was very nice, Elliot was, what I remember of him. And I think he died just recently.
Yeah, it was a couple of years. Did you ever, just back to Joe Sidoni for a second, do you remember any more predictions he made? Did you ever see him be clairvoyant? Did you ever have any experience where he...
Well, it was kind of scary when I think it was during this weekend that we were up here, all of a sudden he goes off in this sort of trance and he says, "Boys," and he said, "I think there's a boat in trouble someplace north of here." Well, so I guess the boys ran over to the beach and looked or something and couldn't see anything. And so nothing more was said about it. And the next day, sure enough, there was a big, some big boat sank out, just south of Pentwater. But it was not really near here, so.
And he had?
Yeah, he had just knew there was something. Some boat was in trouble. It was out there north of here a little bit, but he didn't know where. And so I don't know.
Do you remember the worst storm that you witnessed here again today?
I don't know. There have been some buttes. There was one at... Oh, that was a thrilling rescue by the Coast Guard when they still had their station over here. It was a terribly rough day, and there was a big sailboat. I think this thing was 70 or 80 feet long. Great big thing. And they were trying to get in the channel... And it was really blowing from the northwest. And, you know, the waves were coming over. And they were kept being blown past the channel. And I don't know whether their motor didn't work or it was too windy or too rough. I don't know. But anyway, they were in real trouble. And we all were down on the beach taking pictures of this thing floundering around. And these guys came out in the little surf boat. And got them under tow and got them in. I don't know how they ever did it.
Well, didn't they have to row that boat too?
No, they did have a motor in it that by then. But it was exciting, and that was a wild storm.
And they got them in and you all watched
them? Oh, sure.
Oh, we applauded them?
Oh, yes. They got a big cheer from everybody.
Another person that we don't hear much about, but I understand, was, you know, obviously pictures, maps all the time. Jack DeFrage, do you remember?
Oh, sure, Jack, yes. He was around. He was a very talented artist. I'll be all right.
No problem. And, I can stop if you want.
Oh, yeah, he was around a lot. And everybody, I think, on the beach has one of his maps, I'm sure. And
when did he finally die, or did he leave here?
No, well, he built a house. Well, see, he worked for the Sedoni, for Mr. Sedoni, for quite a while. And then he built a house over there, just up above kind of where their boathouse is, you know, that big thing down there. And and he built a house up there. But anyway, well, when he went into the Navy, he was assigned to the E-Lines had given the Atlantic to the Navy, this three-masted sailing thing. And it was down the Caribbean, and Jack was the captain of it. I guess he was the only one that knew how to sail it anyway.
It's a commission of the Navy.
And so he was mostly in the Caribbean that he was sailing around. I think it was some kind of submarine search, or I don't know exactly what it was. And
defending our country in the Caribbean.
Yeah. And then while he was down there, he came down with trichinosis, which you got from eating underdone pork that wasn't very good to begin with, I guess. And
was that fairly common?
I think it wasn't terribly rare, but it wasn't. But anyhow, so he was sick, really was pretty sick if the rest of his life. From that, and
just one of those diseases, he was never the same.
Never the same after that, and but he, and I think he finally, I think he died of cancer. Finally, it's been a long time ago.
Did he return here after the war and live here?
Oh yes, he lived over here. And, I think he was born in Grand Haven. It was his original home.
Do you remember, I think we didn't know if any sailing school teachers you had or anything? Or
well, see, I was the second
class. Did they have a picture of the second class? I'll have to look for you. That's
and the first class was 1927, I think. Or 20, it was either 28 or, anyway, it was one of those. And, oh, sure, we were all in it. Everybody was in it. And, you know, Bill Getz, the whole, were everybody on the beach. And at that age, we're the same age, you know. And so we were all in that with Jack Guerin and Loker Chittenden. And there was somebody else. I can't remember who it was.
Was Harry Pillinger in your class?
He was in the class, the first class.
Okay.
He was in the year before.
How many years of sailing school did you have?
One. I mean, anybody's smart enough to learn how to sail in a year, for heaven's sakes. So.
What type of boat did you learn in?
Oh, a seaboat. The gaff rig cat. Oh, wonderful. I wish I had one.
Which is what you used to race, too.
Oh, sure. Yeah, sure.
What was the name of your sailboat?
Skipper.
Skipper, okay.
Don't ask me why, but that was the name of it.
In your sailing school class, did you ever turn the boat over or do anything?
Oh, sure. Well, not in the sailing school class, but I remember, well, of course, we sailed over to the yacht club to the races. I mean, nobody, they were all out on buoys. They weren't on lifts or anything. And so we sailed. We were one time, and it was blowing right out of the northwest. And the waves must have been 4 feet high over by the yacht club. And we're sailing free, you know, to get to the, you couldn't come about. There was no way. And here we are. We just, it's boom. Just like that. And
did those seaboats have as bad of a helm as the seaboats I used to race were very bad windward helm? Did yours used to have?
No, I think ours were pretty good. Mm-hmm. And no, those old gaff rigs were wonderful. There were no stays to worry about, backstays or anything like that. And you just.
Oh, what helped the man? Did you?
Well, there were side stays and the forestay, but there were no backstays. And
who used to make the boats?
Palmer.
Palmer boats?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, there were 8 of them were delivered the 1 year. I think it was 28.
Wow.
It was Barb Spear and George Clay and, I don't know, there were 8 of them anyway. And they were all, they took them to the Wob Club and they were all lined up on the floor at the Wob Club. And then we went in and picked out our boat. They were all identical, you know, except for the color of the deck. And
they were right in the Wild Club.
Yeah, sitting there on the floor of the Wild Club. And so we all went around, and I picked out, I don't know, it was a green deck or something like that. And but it was funny. Harry Pillinger had one of that year, too. Well, it was funny because mine was by far the fastest in a light wind, you know, going before the wind or on the reach. And all we'd do is sit there quietly in the bottom of the boat and sail right past everybody else. So,
and, it ran very well.
Yeah, it was so dandy. Well, it was funny because they were all, you know, just identical boats.
How'd you pick yours?
By the color of the deck.
You just like that color?
Yeah, I like that color, and so that's the one I cook.
Did Fitz race that boat together?
No. She never really raced with me. Lucy Lee was always my crew, and Sis Seckel. Sometimes Sunny Seckel, if it was real windy. And it was fun. It was racing days.
Now, Bill Getz was your age, right? You were saying earlier that you were, he was approximately your age. Right?
Oh, yeah.
Now, Bill Getz was an outsider to Sylvan Beach, being, you know, not from Sylvan Beach. Did you have very many others who came in from the, not on Sylvan Beach that you were?
Well, there were quite a few Michelinda people. Uh-huh. And, of course, we all would congregate at the yacht club, and that was where everybody met. And
did you usually, I guess, sail to the yacht club?
Oh, sure.
You usually didn't drive?
Oh, no.
Cars weren't were not a very big part of your youth either.
No. Mm-mm.
And who would need them, really?
Yeah, we never went any place, really, to speak of. Of course, they had movies at the Playhouse. Oh, I wish they had them back now. They're all great movies, you know. We saw everything up there, and they changed the program about twice a week. And
these mix of silent in 29, we went to sound.
I think they were silent in the early days, but then of course they had got sound equipment, and we went to the movies. That was a great movie house.
Now, how'd you get in there? Somebody like Bill Hartz or Bill Getz would
drive. Oh, yeah, somebody would drive, well, or we'd drive in, you know. That was no big deal. And
Well, Mrs. Schmidt, I thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
One more that I like to ask, the biggest wedding you can remember, the one that you really were impressed by, the biggest wedding.
Biggest wedding here?
Yeah, Sylvan Beach.
Well, of course, I wasn't invited to Liz Roosevelt's, but I guess that was the biggest. But I don't know. I think the three Vandeventer girls. Those were the three biggest. They were wonderful. I have movies of Judy's, and they're on tape. I must get her over to look at it. And
those three would be the.
Those three.
Were you by any chance at Peg Vandeventer's wedding?
No, I was a little girl. And I was about.
Betsy Davis was saying she was a little girl and been there. She didn't remember it.
No, I don't remember that, but I do remember when Barb was born, and I was 12. I think 11 or 12. And she used to, Peg would put this little thing out in the buggy, in between the Seckles, which was now the Bitters. And Sis Seckle and I would sit there and stare at this adorable little thing, this mass of curls, you know, all over her hair. Head. She was the cutest little baby. It was the first little baby we'd ever seen, I guess.
Oh, that's neat memory. So you two, I didn't realize they were 12 years apart.
Yeah.
Well, Mrs. Schmidt, I thank you very much. And if you have anything that you'd like to add,
well,
at any time, give a holler in the fall, anytime you want in the summer.
All right. Okay, well, it's been fun. I hope you got something out of it.
Oh, I'm sure we did. I had 50 questions marked down here, and you got through them.
Good.
I appreciate it, and I thank you very much.
Well, you're very welcome. Now, do I just unhitch this?
Yeah.